How about the Values Voter Band? I just renamed them. Aren't they great? Well, it is, it's a privilege to be here with you tonight. Let me also, let's thank Gilmer's. Isn't he a great MC? Is it led us through the whole weekend? I'm not sure where he gets his material, but it's okay. Yeah, I was scanning through the headlines this afternoon, and I found it quite interesting. You know, the media seems to be perplexed by the president's pronouncement yesterday when he was with us that it's going to soon be safe again in America to say Merry Christmas. I mean, they've been trying to figure out what he meant, as if there was some secret code behind that. I mean, literally, I've been asked that by several reporters. What did he mean? I think they were hoping that I would let them in on our secret code. So I just told them, don't tell anybody, but it is the signal to launch the takeover. You know, most of the headlines, I mean, you go like on Drudge, look at most of the headlines deal with the basket of deplorables. Not the same basket of deplorables that Hillary was talking about last year after the Values Voter Summit. This time it's Hollywood. The deplorables. By the way, you did hear that the publisher is recalling Hillary's book. They're going to retitle it. Help, I've fallen and I can't shut up. I did see this another story. This was a new an AP story. A new pastime is spreading across America: hatchet throwing. For real. And I quote from the AP story, quote, "What better, safer way to have fun than drink beer and throw a hatchet?" Continuing, "On a busy Friday night at Stumpy's Hatchet House." Where did he get the name Stumpy? Now, this does tell me that true change is in the air, because this isn't a story out of Louisiana or Southern Virginia. This is out of New Jersey. Explains why the politicians in New Jersey are avoiding town hall meetings. Well, tonight, we're here. We've had a fantastic weekend, and hearing from some of the most dynamic and inspiring leaders in the conservative movement. And I think I can speak for all of us. I think we leave re-energized and recommitted to seizing the moment. This rare moment that doesn't even come with every generation, but an opportunity, a moment that has come in this generation, where we have the opportunity to turn our nation around, to return to our Judeo-Christian foundation. That is our moment. We must seize it. One of the most significant founders in our nation's history is Samuel Adams, one of my favorite. He was described as the last of the great Puritans and the father of the Revolution. And during the quest for freedom, he said this one time. He said, quote, "It does not take a majority to prevail, but rather an irate, tireless minority keen on setting brush fires of freedom in the minds of men." And I can't think of a better description of the role of radio in the modern political movement than setting brush fires of freedom in the minds and the hearts of men. And few have been more successful in that mission than the man we honor here tonight. For over 40 years as chairman of the board of Salem Communications, Stu Epperson's vision and leadership have brought positive and life-changing messages that have influenced the spiritual and the cultural and the political landscape of America. As co-founder of Salem, starting in a rural farmhouse in Virginia, he has combined his extensive executive and political experience to provide a cultural bedrock of Christian and family-themed content and conservative values that has swept the country. Through Salem's family of radio networks, print media, publishing, and online presence, very few people in the conservative movement have done more to shape the national conversation than Stu Epperson. It is because of his faith and his foresight and his leadership. And Stu, it is for these reasons and so many more that we have gathered here tonight with you and with your family. And I know you're a humble guy. You didn't want to do this and probably think, you know, what's all the fuss? But this is biblical. It's a celebration of biblical proportions. But it's biblical in what we do. Romans chapter 12, verse 10 says this, "Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Outdo yourselves in honoring one another." We want to give you the honor that is due you tonight, Stu. So sit back and be blessed and hear from those who count you as a dear friend and as a source of inspiration. And with that, let us begin our time together tonight. And I want to invite one of Stu's closest and oldest friends, Richard Viguerie. Richard is called the funding father of the conservative movement. In fact, he even worked in one of my campaigns raising money for me. Richard Viguerie transformed American politics in the 1960s and 70s by pioneering the use of direct mail fundraising in the political and ideological spheres. He used the computerized direct mail fundraising to help build the conservative movement, which then elected Ronald Reagan as the first conservative president of the modern era. We are grateful to have him with us tonight. And Richard, with his family ties, go back to Louisiana, so he knows a little bit about the swamp. And so he's one of the swamp drainers. Please welcome Richard Viguerie.
Thank you, Tony. It's a very special honor for me to be asked to speak tonight about my dear, dear friend, Stu Epperson. And quite frankly, I know Stu feels honored also to receive this award because he's receiving it from the Family Research Council. It is no organization in America, in my opinion, has done more to protect, preserve, and pass on to generations unborn the blessings of liberty, including the blessings of religious liberty, traditional values, support for the institution of marriage, family, and the blessings of liberty and freedom under God's laws. Family Research Council, under the leadership of Tony and General Jerry Boykin and many, many other dedicated team members, has been absolutely indispensable to the battle, actually war, that we're in for the very soul of America. So we are all in your debt, Tony, Jerry, and all the other leaders of FRC. Thank you. Now, why am I here? Oh, to say something nice about my friend Stu. Okay, Stu. But before I say something nice about you, Stu, I want to make sure that everybody understands that when we're praising Stu here today, we really are also including Nancy Etzinger Epperson. Yeah. Yes, certainly, Stu, you have achieved great things, but I know you'd be the first to say that you did it with Nancy, and she's been your partner in these many achievements and successes, and I know you're like me, you wouldn't have accomplished a fraction without your lovely wife there. So we're deeply indebted to you too, Nancy. Professionally, there are many ways to describe Stu. My favorite is that when I see Stu Epperson, I see the personification of an entrepreneur, and I know Stu likes to think of himself as an entrepreneur, as I do. He's a highly successful entrepreneur and leader, from his 6'6" frame, top of his head to his toes. He's an entrepreneur, businessman. But Stu is also an entrepreneur in his personal life, starting and leading churches, charities, conservative organizations, twice a candidate for Congress. But my personal favorite entrepreneurship of Stu is all of the work, the organizations that he's done to help young people, particularly young people at risk, and even more specific than that, young boys and men. Stu not only starts, leads, donates his time and treasure, but he walks with these young men. Thousands of mornings, Stu gets up on a Saturday morning and goes into the housing projects by himself and finds groups of young men hanging around. Nothing to do that day, nothing to do with their life. Most of them don't know who their father is. I remember years ago, Stu talking to me about one of these young men whose name was Tim. And Tim didn't know who his father was, and Stu began to mentor him. And today he's known as Dr. Tim, with a wife and children because of Stu Epperson's mentoringship. Stu takes these young men, they're hanging out on a Saturday morning, and he says, I've got some yard work that needs to be done. I've got a garage that needs to be cleaned out at my home. Would y'all mind coming over? I'll pay you. And they do. A few hours later, Stu takes them to McDonald's for lunch. Ask him, what are you going to do this year? What are you going to do with the rest of your life? He talks to them about things no one had ever talked to them about before. And has changed thousands and thousands of lives. Only God knows how many lives have been changed by Stu and Nancy. The Stu is a role model for these thousands of young boys, young men, but is also a role model for people like myself. Stu has been a personal role model of mine for years. He probably didn't know that. But he's also a role model for just about everybody that knows him. And I know of no better way to honor Stu, or anybody that you particularly look up to and admire, as I do Stu, than to identify a particular characteristic that they have and take it unto yourself and adopt it for yourself. And Stu would be thrilled to know that we honor him today by adopting that characteristic of his, which is reaching out to people, helping people who have the ability to never repay him at all. So every day, as Stu does, reach out and try to help somebody who will never be able to repay you. I want to close by quoting, in one way it doesn't sound appropriate, but I think it is. Passage from the Bible, 2 Samuel, 3rd chapter, 38th verse. King David is talking about someone who has passed away and regretting the death. And the passage is, "And the king said to his people, know ye not that this day a prince, a great man, has fallen." So our friend has not fallen, long from it. But he is a version of that passage. "And do you not know that this day a great man walks with us? So therefore, go forth and do as Stu Epperson does." Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. I can assure you it is always appropriate to quote the Bible here at the Values Voter Summit. This is not the Democratic Convention. Our next presenter of the evening was on this stage just 6 years ago as the recipient of our Vision and Leadership Award. This is a man who, after a distinguished career in public service, really deserved to enjoy retirement, and yet he loves his country and his grandkids too much to call it a day. He's an amazing man. He's one of my heroes. He continues to serve in the movement as the Ronald Reagan Distinguished Fellow Emeritus at the Heritage Foundation and the Chairman Emeritus of the Conservative Action Project, and we have a donut together every Wednesday morning. I'm sorry, I wasn't supposed to let Ursula hear that. He was the 75th Attorney General of the United States under President Ronald Reagan. Please welcome the Honorable Ed Meese. Thank you, General.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for that generous introduction, Tony, and certainly the warm welcome. It's a great pleasure and an honor for me to be here tonight to join in this celebration and honoring of our good friend Stu Epperson. As a matter of fact, the whole idea of being able to honor him in this surroundings at the Value Voters Conference under the auspices of the Family Research Council is fitting in so many different ways, because Stu represents the best of those people who are believers, those people who are workers for the kingdom, but also people who are successful in business, successful in their political realm in terms of passing on the liberty and the other values that are so important to our country. And so really to be here and join in this celebration that Richard talked about there of a great man of God and a man who is so important to our country for so many reasons. You know, this is the, as Tony pointed out, this is an award for vision and leadership. And certainly Stu is the epitome of this. Those particular traits which are so important to our country today, where we need both vision and leadership in order to steer us back to where this country has been in the past and where we hope it's going in the future. By the way, anybody who could inspire a musical tribute like we just had this evening certainly deserves a lot of attention from all of us. The author Ralph Waldo Emerson wrote that, quote, every great institution is the lengthened shadow of a single man. And he went on to say, his character determines the character of the organization. Those are words that particularly apply to Stu Epperson. Several organizations have thrived in the shadow of and by the leadership of our honoree tonight. Obviously, the Salem Media Organization, and I'll talk a little bit about that. Obviously, the National Religious Broadcasters, where he has been a leader for so long. Obviously, the Council for National Policy, where the heads of conservative organizations and the major donors of organizations come together. And Stu has been a leader there and has been president of that organization. And then, as Richard said, he has been so active in youth-serving organizations, both in terms of leadership, but also in terms of person-to-person counseling. Most people don't realize that Time magazine, which is not always the most accurate portrayer of either people who have leadership or who have vision, selected Stu to be one of the 25 most influential evangelicals in America. And it was in their article that I found something very interesting. I assume that it is true. And that was that the source, you have to be a little careful these days with the media. In any event, it said that a 10-year-old Stuart Epperson was reading Bible verses from a radio station that his brother had built in their family's Virginia farmhouse at the early stages of his life. Well, that was the start, apparently. But by age 36, Stu had bought his first AM station in Roanoke, Virginia. And again, to quote Time, that would be the beginning of a religious and political broadcasting powerhouse. Now, we use the term powerhouse to describe football players, sometimes political figures, but believe me, this is the first time that it was used truly correctly, because Stu Epperson is the kindest, the gentlest, and the genuinely humble powerhouse that I have ever met. But a powerhouse he is, and is the epitome of servant leadership. Under the leadership of Stu and his brother-in-law, Ed Atzinger, for example, the Salem Media Group has risen to become one of the most influential communication vehicles and communicating about the things that are important to keep reminding our public. Things like the principles of liberty, the importance of religion. One of the great things that has been forgotten by most people or have never learned by too many of our young people today is that America would never have been founded as it is if it was not for the desire of the people who came here for religious liberty. And that's why today, when religious liberty is under attack, as has never been before, it's important to have organizations like the Salem Media Group and leaders like Stu Epperson. You know, it started with radio and it went on and now involves publishing and it involves newsletters and commentary. It involves the internet. In other words, the entire spectrum of communication is a part of what Stu is leading. And the organization and its leaders have never lost its vision or its purpose and has been willing to stand firm when so many institutions in our country have gone a different route or have been unwilling to stand up for what is right or who have been absent when firm leadership is needed. But that's not the way that Salem has gone, and that's because of the leader who gives it the inspiration and gives it the vision. Salem and Stu have always been dedicated to serving the kingdom of God and the principles of our constitutional republic. Beyond that, though, as was pointed out by Richard, and as we know, those of us who have the privilege of working with Stu, and that is, he is a great family man. The Family Research Council couldn't have picked a better example of a person with a marvelous wife, 4 children, and 21 grandchildren, at least at last count. And certainly that example that goes along with his leadership example is a great one for our country. And of course, Stu has been a great friend to so many of us. He has been, particularly in his leadership of the Council for National Policy, taken an organization of leaders themselves and brought them together, unified them, and set them in a course of action which has been in the nature of preserving our religious liberty as well as improving and expanding the liberty of the people generally and certainly the institutions that make up our country. Stu's influence extends really to those who hold the highest office and the highest positions in business in this land. But he is also influenced through himself and the organizations he's headed, millions of people throughout society that nobody will know much about, but where their personal lives have been influenced by what he has been doing and what he has set in motion. I came across a testimonial recently from an ordinary citizen that recognizes what Stu has done. And this person was writing to the Salem Media Group, and what they said about what they had experienced really gives us a message that is about what Stu stands for and what he has done. And this person, who Stu will never know, it was an anonymous person, sent this message, said, "I wish to use this opportunity to show my immense gratitude and appreciation on your efforts to making God's word a reality to me personally and to the world at large." That's certainly the message that all of us transmit to you tonight, Stu, as you receive this award with the love and appreciation of all of us here. Thank you.
Thank you, General Meese. Well, many of the people who dearly love Stu and wanted to be here to celebrate this occasion with us tonight are not able to be here. And tonight we have a video from one of, I think, many who would like to honor Stu. And this is from the former Speaker of the House, Newt Gingrich. Sad to miss. He wanted to send this video message for his friend of over 30 years. So please turn your attention to the screen.
I want to thank the Value Voters Summit for singling out Stu Epperson as somebody really worthy of honoring and of studying. I first met Stu many years ago when he was running for Congress. In fact, over 30 years ago. He was a great entrepreneur, deeply committed family man, and a devout Christian. I ran into him just a few weeks ago when he was on a trip to Europe with all of his extended family. Same guy, deeply committed Christian, deeply committed family man, and a real entrepreneur. He has done more to help move the radio system into conservatism than any other single person in his generation. He has very intelligently understood where the technology was going, and he's used that technology to help get our message of solid conservatism, of key values, out to millions and millions of people. He's still an active, aggressive supporter of the kind of America all of us believe in, and he's played a major role in bringing together a conservative movement capable of achieving that kind of America. So, Stu, congratulations on this great recognition.
Coming now to honor Stu is Rebecca Hagelin. Rebecca is a weekly columnist with the Washington Times. She owns Rebecca Hagelin Communications and Marketing, a boutique radio marketing firm that specializes in endorsed embedded campaigns with select hosts for both businesses and nonprofit organizations. Rebecca is also the secretary of the Executive Committee of the Council for National Policy, and she serves on the board of directors for Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk. She and her husband, Andy, are dear friends of Stu and Nancy. Please welcome Rebecca Hagelin.
Thank you, friend. Thank you, Tony. You've heard already, it mentioned several times, about Stu Epperson's work in the inner cities. But if you will, just take your mind with me for a moment in what that must look like. It's an unusual image that's often seen in the projects in inner cities of Florida and North Carolina. Picture it, a tall, slim, white man walking in neighborhoods that perhaps some of us in this room, if we're honest with ourselves, might fear, mostly out of ignorance. This man couldn't hide his frame even if he wanted to, because Stu Epperson is a very tall man. In fact, he's a giant among men, not because of his height, but because of how he helps others. Week after week, year after year, Stu doesn't just walk through those streets handing out gospel tracts or, say, Thanksgiving baskets. Although Stu does these good things, his love goes much further. Stu walks like Jesus does, right into the lives of the broken and the hurting. He enters the homes of those who often have no hope. He dares to form real and abiding relationships with people who are suffering. He holds the hands of the brokenhearted and embraces children who have never known a father's love. And in so doing, Stu becomes the face of our Heavenly Father. President Trump rightly speaks about the forgotten man and the forgotten woman, about how government overlooks so many. But for Stu Epperson, no one is ever forgotten. Always the mentor, ever the giver, unselfishly, sacrificially, and oh so very cheerfully ministering to others. This is the man that the Family Research Council honors tonight. And how fitting that FRC would choose to honor Stu Epperson at the Values Voters Summit, because I can think of no one who understands better and demonstrates more fully that when we put our conservative values and timeless principles into action, we improve human lives. Conservative principles and values offer real hope and real help. And who is it that undergirds everything Stu does? Well, of course, his beautiful wife, Nancy. I've never met a more godly woman. Nancy, thank you for showing those who know you how to deepen our understanding of Scripture. I still think about you every time I meditate on Psalm 103, because it was you who encouraged me to memorize it. Thank you for teaching so many of us to hold truth close in our hearts and in our minds. And thank you for being an amazing example of a mom and grandmother. You and Stu have created a beautiful family composed of beautiful people inside and out. In fact, I think 32 of them are with us this evening. And tonight, Nancy, I especially thank you for being the force that helps propel your husband into scores of endeavors that further the biblical principles that bless so many people. Placing principles and people first, that's what Stu has always done. And in business, he has also always extolled the virtue of making an honest profit. Stu Epperson understands that it is both incredible benevolence and principled prosperity that makes America exceptional among all nations. Stu will never apologize for virtuous capitalism or for being successful. He knows that profitability allows us to have the resources to unleash and share with those in need, as Stu and Nancy do every day. As Tom Tradup, a Salem executive and friend, told me, Stu always calls for Salem employees to be good business people. Tom says, Stu's mantra is, remember, you can't spell Salem without S-A-L-E. But more importantly, he believes that integrity sits on both sides of the negotiating table, and he encourages staff and management to always do the right thing. Stu, I'm honored to work with such a company under your leadership in my own marketing business. Stu also demonstrates how sterling character, coupled with entrepreneurial drive that includes the willingness to take a calculated risk on a new initiative or a new person, can be incredibly rewarding for all parties involved. Unafraid of either failure or success, Stu works hard to not only achieve the American dream, to make it possible for others to dream and achieve too. For example, when many other conservatives were abandoning media decades ago because it was becoming progressively worse, like what happens with everything progressives control, things get progressively worse, Stu and his equally visionary brother-in-law, Ed Adsinger, began to invest in media. And thanks to their vision, risk-taking brains and guts, they now give us Hugh Hewitt and Dennis Prager and Eric Metaxas and Michael Medved and Mike Gallagher and Larry Elder. Through Salem's music stations, they also fill homes and cars and millions of hearts with encouraging and life-giving Christian music. They also give us real news on the internet through Town Hall and Red State and Crosswalk, and they publish truth and the best in conservative thought through the Regnery imprint. And through their teaching stations, Salem provides a platform for sharing biblical truth to millions of people from godly teachers like Al Mohler and Dr. James Dobson. Speaking of Dr. Dobson, on whose board of directors I serve for Family Talk, I bring you personal greetings, Stu. Our board is launching the Dr. James Dobson Family Institute this very night at our largest gathering of the year, taking place right now in Colorado Springs. But Doc and I felt that I should be here tonight to honor you. Dr. Dobson sends his personal congratulations and gratefulness for your service to our nation. As one of the founders of the Family Research Council, Dr. Dobson is grateful that FRC saw fit to select you for the Vision and Leadership Award. As we all know, Dr. Dobson has been among the most listened to voices in the entire world, and he knows, Stu, that you and Salem have been responsible for many of those stations that still carry his words of wisdom to hurting families across the land. This successful partnership, you on the business side, taking enormous financial risk, Dr. Dobson on the ministry side, providing real help and content, can serve as a model for everyone in this room tonight. When the business person and those who educate the grassroots partner in endeavors to provide truth to live by, we preserve our ability to live as free people. In fact, it is this type of partnership vision that is the mission of the Council for National Policy, which Stu so wisely led as the president for 3 years, and for which Tony Perkins now brilliantly serves as president. Stu, it was one of my greatest honors to have debated directions and policies and served by your side as a member of CMP's executive committee. Thank you for all you taught me about strategic thinking and graciousness in that process. We can all continue to learn a lot about vision and leadership from Stu Epperson. Stu encourages us to be bolder, inspires us to be kinder, challenges us to work smarter, motivates us to be more generous, and shows us how to be more like Christ. Although we honor you tonight, Stu, through one of mankind's greatest organizations, the Family Research Council, we know there is a much bigger award awaiting you. One day, you will bask in the glory of our Lord and in the company of that great cloud of witnesses, the saints who have gone before us, and they will testify to the story of your loving life. And when you see the faces of those who were once lost, but are now eternally saved, partly because of how you allow God to direct your path, well, that will be your greatest reward. And one day, Stu, when you see Jesus face to face, in that moment, you will hear from the lips of our Lord, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." And we all say here tonight, "Well done, Stu Epperson, God's good and faithful servant."
Thank you, Rebecca. Our next presenter is one of Salem's media hottest talkers. He is a familiar voice to many of us in this room, especially those who enjoy conservative talk radio between 6 and 9 a.m. Eastern each weekday. This summer, he began hosting his own Saturday morning show on MSNBC. He's a mole. And he's become a frequent commentator on Meet the Press before he became one of the most influential radio hosts In America, he served for nearly 6 years in the Reagan administration in various posts, including assistant counsel in the White House and special assistant to two attorneys general, including Ed Meese. And I'm sure you know who I'm referring to, so please help me welcome to the stage Mr. Hugh Hewitt.
Thank you, Tony. It's unique to sit with your current boss, Stu, and one of your first bosses, General Meese, at dinner. And I'm a little more informal than our other speakers. I want to impress on you one unique thing about Stu Epperson. It's an honor, Tony, to be asked to speak about Stu. But Salem has 100 radio stations and dozens of websites and thousands of books in print. And thousands of people work for Salem. And they are all jealous of me, who has the opportunity to say a few words about Stu Epperson, because they all love you, Stu, every single one. And about who can that be said in corporate America, that every single one of your employees would be jealous of the opportunity to stand up and sing the praises of your boss? Before I do that, though, and we know a lot about Stu. He is a believer in radio. He ran for Congress twice. He believed in my career, so on common sense, that's three strikes and you're out. But he's a man of conviction. And I want to begin, though, by talking about the person who gives him that conviction. Salem Media has two first ladies. All right, so Mona Atzinger and Nancy Epperson have been every step of the way, along with the co-founders of this group. And Nancy is every bit as wonderful and winsome as Stu. And the mansions of the Lord have many rooms, but you get the best view, Nancy, because you have put up with the wildest ride. I confirmed on the way in. I checked with Nancy because I had read this. She was an infant on Pearl Harbor when the bombs fell, and that prepared her for the life of being married to Stu Epperson. Moving quickly to the mainland, always ready for anything, always happy with any challenge, and always the First Lady of Salem and doing it so effortlessly well. And to all of Stu's children and great number of grandchildren are here tonight. 70 years hence, you're going to be able to say that your grandfather and your grandmother were great people, and they contributed to a great republic in great and enduring ways. I have been reading a book called Destiny of the Republic by Candace Miller. It's about a great Buckeye, James Garfield. I'd recommend it to you all. And when James Garfield was nominated in 1880 to become the president, the Republican Party was deeply split between the stalwarts, and they called them the half-breeds. And the stalwarts wanted Grant, and the half-breeds wanted James Blaine of Maine, and they fought, and they made our troubles look like a tea party. And out of that emerged a few voices that brought everyone together, and that's what Stu has done. And that is what he has worked to do. But when Garfield was nominated in 1880, the great Frederick Douglass, himself a former slave, one of the great voices of the freedmen, booked the room at Union Cooper's in New York, Cooper's Union. And it filled up with an amazing integrated group of people. Thousands of people came. And he used a line in talking about James Garfield that made me think of Stu when I heard it this week. He's traveled on a road that he built. He said that about James Garfield, and I thought about Stu and the fact that he has traveled on a road that he built with that first radio station up to this incredible empire of influence and reach. All along the way, unfailingly courteous, pleasant, always a witness to Christ, always winsome. And if you look up winsome, you're going to find Stu Epperson's face next to that definition in there. But you've heard other people say already, I could tell you a lot about the business successes and the political successes, but it is no accident that 4 out of 4 of the live people testifying to Stu tonight brought up his work. I must say, he's done his fair share of helping the Holy Spirit in converting men and women across the United States. He has created platforms for some of the greatest voices of the gospel ever to have worked in the United States, much less worked in radio and reached millions. He has made it possible in an era of unlimited access to make that access redemptive. And that is the message of Salem. It's redemptive radio. It's redemptive content. But I always approach Stu with a little bit of trepidation when I see him, always with a little bit, because I know if I even begin to say Section 8, the inner evangelist will spring out, full of passion and urgency, full of the need to convert the already converted and those who are standing around to the fact that in Section 8 housing in the United States, there are 5 million families, and a lot of those families are without fathers. And Stu has gone not just himself into those places. He has made it his life work to recruit and place in there men, typically veterans of the United States military, to live in those housing and to be fathers to the fatherless. And if you get Stu talking about that, you will hear in those words, in those minutes, the extraordinary passion of someone who realizes that unless you put fathers into families, they cannot model the Father in heaven who exists for each and every one of us. And so of all those things that he's accomplished, and we could be up here, you could have 40 speakers, talk about 50 different things as Stu Epperson and Nancy Epperson have done. I think it is beyond, I think, an argument that his work on behalf of those Section 8 kids is amazing. Section 8 dates back to 1937. 1937 it began, and it's managed by HUD. I don't care who's worked for HUD, even the wonderful Dr. Carson. Whoever's managed it, no one's prayed for it more than Stu Epperson has. And that is a remarkable, remarkable accomplishment. So all of us in this room have accomplished something to be here. We've all done a lot. But I am reminded, and I think it's appropriate because it's the FRC, to close this with a little bit of our scripture. In the last week of his life, Christ gave some admonitions to his disciples. And in Matthew 25, 34, 40, he's talking to them about what's going to happen at the last judgment. And Jesus says, then the king will say to those on his right, come you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger. You invited me in naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him. I think about Stu and Nancy at this point saying, Lord, when did he see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in naked or clothe you? And when did we see you sick in prison and come to you? And the king will answer to them, truly I say to you, to the extent that you did it to one of these brothers of mine, even the least of them, you did it to me. So here's my plan. When that trumpet sounds and the last day arrives, Betsy and I are going to try and get close to Nancy and Stu. Now, around them is going to be a great legion of children, as you have heard everyone say, an enormous legion of children, their own wonderful four children, their 30-plus grandchildren, who knows how many great-grandchildren are coming. But there's going to be this great company of kids, because Stu has been working side by side with them for many, many decades. And so if for no other reason, but it's in fact the most important reason at all, join me in honoring a great American and a great voice for redemptive radio, but also for freedom and for hope for those kids, Stu Epperson. Congratulations, Stu.
Thank you, Hugh. Our final speaker tonight first met Stu and Nancy more than 13 years ago while still an undergraduate student. They quickly became her mentors and transformed her life in so many ways. Stephanie Acosta Inks is a legal fellow and adjunct professor at Georgetown University Law Center, where she teaches a course in religious liberty. She has served on the board of directors of the Christian Association of Youth Mentoring, and we welcome her to the stage to share about Stu and Nancy Epperson. Please welcome Stephanie Ace. Welcome, Stephanie.
Hugh, I will be one of those children, as you said, standing around Stu and Nancy. As I was leaving to come here tonight, my kids were sad to see Mommy go, and my five-year-old was saying, why do you have to go, Mommy? And I said, I get to go thank the man who helped give us things like our house and your toys. You wouldn't have those probably either. And he said, he gave me my house and my toys? I said, honey, he gave your mommy her education, which helped us get our house and all that you see around you. It's cliche to say that there aren't words to describe when someone has impacted your life like Stu and Nancy Epperson have. And I don't mean to be cliche, but it's really true in this case. And I'm a lawyer. I always have something to say. I'm never at a loss for words, but I am in this case. I first met them 13 years ago when I was an undergraduate student, and a mutual friend introduced us because they knew that I shared a passion for mentoring at-risk kids. And when I first sat down with Mr. Epperson for the first time that Sunday afternoon, he could have been, he could have treated me with even, an ounce of disrespect, or he could have been patronizing. He's a very successful man, and I'm, a young college graduate. But he wasn't like that at all. He asked a lot of questions, and I told him about how those of us in the field doing at-risk mentoring wanted to start a national organization to help launch more Christian ministries. And he put his money where his mouth was. He practiced what he preached, and he laid the foundation for a national association of Christian youth mentoring that today is impacting the lives of thousands of kids across this country and even the world. Because of them, I was able to become an attorney. I was educated at one of the best law schools in the country. I didn't have the resources or the judgment even at that time to realize and understand how important going to one of the best schools, the best law schools in the country would be. In fact, I don't even think I had the judgment at that time, you probably remember better than I do, to even go to law school. But they saw in me something that I didn't even see in myself. My sights were honestly set too low, but they changed that. If it wasn't for your guidance, I would have probably gone to a mediocre state school, but instead I went to Georgetown. And my entire future was changed because of their support and guidance. I wouldn't have been recruited by a top 10 global firm, which meant I wouldn't have been able to put my husband through a top business school, which meant that he wouldn't be able to do the amazing work he's doing on the Hill today. I wouldn't have been able to support the young woman that I mentor through her Teen Challenge residency program to overcome successfully her addiction. I wouldn't have been able to help my family and countless others in many ways. I wouldn't have been able to teach constitutional law at LSU, and I certainly wouldn't have been able to make the transition that I'm trying to make now into legal academia as a professor at Georgetown. The ripple effect of their guidance and their mentoring and generosity to me is immeasurable this side of heaven. Although we don't always agree on everything, I never cease to be amazed by their generosity, grace, and integrity. I don't know what I would do if I wasn't able to just pick up the phone and call them when I need life guidance. And I mean that not just professionally. I've learned so much from them in my marriage, in my parenting, and in my relationship with God. I know that they do everything as unto the Lord. And so today, I want to thank you for changing my life, for seeing in me God-given talents that I didn't even see in myself, because I know I'm a life that's changed. My family's life has been changed. And countless, literally, Hugh, countless other young people's lives have been changed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. I've had the privilege of working with Stu at the Council for National Policy when he was the chairman. I was the vice chairman for a number of years and worked along with him as we worked in that secretive right-wing, vast right-wing conspiracy that we have been a part of. And, it was a pleasure to work with him and watch him and steal a few of his jokes every now and then. But you really get to know someone when you're sitting around a campfire. And he has a farm in rural Virginia, and the General Boykin actually goes there frequently, and we go deer hunting occasionally. When you're down there sitting around the fire, you really learn about someone. Especially General Boykin when he's drinking his cough syrup out of the brown paper bag, but that's another issue. He told me it was cough syrup. Stu and I are Baptists, so we believe him.
We are telling.
But as we were sitting around telling the stories, some true, some not so true, but Stu told some stories of his interaction with his father. And as I listened, because, you know, with the general there, my stories are nothing compared to his. And so I listened most of the time. And Stu was telling stories of his dad. And his dad grew up in a rural part of Virginia and was just a hardworking man. And he learned those values from his father. But what he learned from his father was something you could never learn in an institution of higher learning. And even though we may send young people to school, with the absence of a father, they'll never learn those things that will truly make them successful. And it was there that I saw the reason that Stu has invested so much of his life in going back into these communities where children are deprived of fathers, because of the profound effect his father had upon his life. And as I listened, I reflected even on my own relationship with my own father, and I'm so thankful that my father's still alive and have the ability to cherish that relationship. And because, Stu, of the things that you said there, it made me reflect on even a greater sense of value that I place on my own relationship with my father. And so it is for a host of reasons tonight that we recognize Stu Epperson. And, you know, when someone has gone through, you know, the corporate America, the political environment, and they're still going strong, and they haven't discredited themselves, nor the movement, nor God, nor anything else, but yet they remain fixed. And that's, we all have feet of clay. I get that. I understand that. But we should strive for the prize. And I believe that Stu Epperson is doing just that. And tonight, that is why we honor you, Stu, for everything about you and Nancy in your professional and private life, and we thank you. And at this time, I would like to ask you and Nancy to join me here on the stage as we present the Family Research Council Vision and Leadership Award. Allow me just a moment to read the citation on this award. The conscientious matching of deeds with words is the essence of integrity and the mark of a true Christian. For Stuart W. Epperson, this coherence of character has defined his course over an extraordinary career. From his early days of radio from a farmhouse in rural Virginia to today's complex matrix of communications that span the globe, Stuart has been a pioneer of innovation, taking to heart the admonition of Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, to go and teach. He has found dynamic ways to deliver biblical truth and family values to millions nationwide through some of the most inspired authors and voices in America. What he and his partner, Ed Adsigner III, have built at Salem Media Group is not so much an empire of influence among men as kingdom of service to our Lord. In countless ways, Stuart has shown the same qualities through his charitable engagements in his beloved North Carolina, in Florida, and across the nation. He has devoted himself to the needs of youth for mentorship and discipleship, as well as to the need of young mothers for pregnancy support and aftercare. The greatest vision is the ability to see over the horizon, both backwards and forwards. treasuring our glorious heritage of faith and looking ahead to the prospering of new generations. The greatest love is the willingness to lay down one's life for others. For such foresight and the love of the Family Research Council is pleased to celebrate the living legacy of Stuart W. Epperson and to honor him tonight with our Vision and Leadership Award, given this 14th day of October in the city of Washington, D.C., in the year of our Lord, 2017. Please help me in honoring Stuart W. Epperson.
Stu wanted our children to come up here, and our grandchildren, and our children and their spouses, and our grandchildren to come up just quickly. And while they're coming up, I'll give a brief comment before Stu gives his remarks. And I want to thank you all for honoring this wonderful man to me. Oh, please sit down. For me, the greatest, truly the greatest man in the world, and I really do mean that. And I can say that after 54 years of marriage. So, so I just want to tell you that these are our precious, not all of them, but most of our, many of our grandchildren. Of course, our four kids are here and their spouses, except Kathy's husband, who's a pastor, couldn't come because he had to be at church in the morning to preach. But because he had missed a couple on a missions trip, so he couldn't miss another Sunday. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. But the other spouses are here. We're proud of them. We love them all. These are our precious grandchildren. And we just wanted you to meet them, meet the family, the rest of the family. thank you. You may go back now. Thank you. And let me just say briefly, I did not grow up in a Christian home, nor did my brother Edward, Stu's partner. When I was 14, I was invited to church, and I heard the gospel for the first time, that Christ loved me and died on the cross, was buried, he rose again. If I would accept him, my life would be changed. He would make me his child, and I did that, and it was all true. My life was changed. And when I made that life-changing decision, I determined I would only marry a Christian, somebody who loved God. And I wouldn't even date somebody who didn't love God, because every date is a potential mate. And you listen to me, grandchildren. And my only one and only grandchild who has married, Hope, is here with her wonderful godly husband. So they're listening. But anyway, I held out for God's best, and you know what? God honored that, and he gave me his very best, and I do thank the Lord for my wonderful husband, and truly, I was interviewed recently, and the lady said, well, just please tell me the secret of 54 years of marriage, and I said, well, of course, putting God first and at the center of our relationship, which we've always determined to do. But I said, I just have to be frank with you. The real secret is I just married Stu Epperson, a wonderful man. That's the secret of our successful marriage, honestly. So thank you for this honor, and you have chosen a wonderful person to honor. And I share in honoring him also with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Tony, thank you so much. LaWanda, thank you. You guys are a great couple and you're a great team, so thank you for what you do. And thank you, the guys who spoke up here so eloquently, and I'll not take the time that might be necessary to correct any errors, but you know, this started to sound like a eulogy tonight. And I asked Rebecca, Was that when the saints go marching in that we heard? Anyway, it doesn't bother me. I'm getting old, and my dad was an undertaker, and I'm very much aware of what nature has, God has designed for all of us. My dad actually was in the undertaker business on the farm, and did the whole thing, made the coffin, started out making coffins for $2, and then he got into doing the whole funeral, and he always said, you know, these things, I can make them, and the coffin and put it, you know, they're very shallow back then. They were wooden, very shallow, and I can slide them right under the bed. And anyway, if you go into the funeral business, don't do it out of your house, please. Doesn't work. These guys that talked about me tonight are all my heroes, great guys, except maybe Hugh, but but Hugh and Betsy are a great part of our family at Salem. Thank you, Hugh, especially, and all the others. General Meese, my hero, and I felt like in this journey, I felt like that I was there thinking of these things that have happened, and I've been given, you graciously gave me credit for it, but I've got to tell you, and I've got to tell you, I was sitting there with Nancy today, and I said, you know, what are we doing here? I mean, why are we here, okay? And I concluded, you know, God did this. I was there, she was there, God did it. And Christ was in our lives all the way, looking back. And I've never really reflected on it very much, but there's some people that I met along the way, and I want to mention a few of them. First, my mother and father. My dad was a veteran of World War I, he was a farmer. They called them dirt farmers back then, raised a little tobacco patch, and we all grew up on the farm. I was born on that farm, in that old farmhouse, and my grandmother was the midwife that delivered me, this was a house that had no heat and had no bathroom and had no electricity until I was 8 years old. And my dad had no car until I was 12 years old. That was the kind of family we grew up in. But these people prayed a lot, my mother and father. My father was 5'8", my mother was 6 feet tall. They were kind of, I frankly, to my very embarrassment, I used to be a little apprehensive about being seen in public with them. They were older, and but you know, I felt ashamed of myself, and I repented of that. They were the greatest people I've ever known. A missionary came from Waco, Texas, Susie Sleeper, and started a cottage prayer meeting down the road, their road, and out of that grew a church. And my dad had a little sawmill. He and his brother sawed out the lumber, and they went around and collected. Got people to donate eggs and a chicken and maybe a bushel of wheat and a ham or something to sell, chiefly to buy the bell for the church and nails. They did the rest. And so he built the church. He was a carpenter also, and then he was the first superintendent of the Sunday school, elder. And I was so, and so that was our, that was what we spent our time at home and at church. I look back on it, and I'm so thankful for that. It was work. My dad was old school. My mother was old school. We ate what we grew. We sewed. My Aunt Dora was a great seamstress. And then one change in life was my brother served at the Naval Labs, went out to John Brown, by the way. We heard he got a radio while he was in high school, and they heard Dr. John Brown preaching on the radio early in the morning. And on this radio, it was a radio that was battery powered, and the battery was charged by a windmill on top of the house. I remember that windmill. It was slightly out of round, and it would go thump, thump, thump when the wind was blowing real hard. That's an interesting sound. And people used to come to our house to hear the Grand Ole Opry on Saturday night. We were kind of the center of the community there. And he came home then he went to John Brown. They said, if you can get out here and you're willing to work, you can get an education. You don't need any money, they said. And so my Aunt Dora sewed some nice shirts from flour sacks, which is what we wore, and with a pair of bib overalls, we dropped him off. I got Buster Smith, who had a truck down the road, and I remember going on that Monday morning and set him off at the intersection of 601 and Main Street in Mount Airy, North Carolina, and he stood there to catch a ride to go to John Brown. And then we heard from him a week and a half later with a postcard. He got there and he liked school. They put him in the dairy at first to work, and he said, "I can't stand farming. I've had too much farming already." And they agreed to let him work at the radio station. And he went there and turned out to be valedictorian. He was a bright young man. And came back and worked at the Naval Lab and then started a radio station in our house. 1 year after we got electricity, by the way, okay. And he wired the house. So every Friday night, all day Saturday, and all day Sunday afternoon, the whole community from the mountain there, the southern Blue Ridge Mountains, southern Appalachians, would come to our house, and they would bring their guitars and banjos and fiddles and harmonicas, and they would sing, and they would do all kinds of things. And then preachers would come with big black Bibles, and they would preach, and Ralph would say, "Well, how long you want to preach?" He'd put them all on, and someone would say, "I'd like to preach an hour." Okay, we said, "Well, have at it. You got the next hour." So they'd start preaching, and they were great preachers, a little bit loud at times, not always good English, but they got it right. Okay, the gospel of Jesus Christ, they got it right in the basic words of it. So I grew up with that atmosphere, and when I was 12, he opened a radio station in Mount Airy, and I started working there, and then I became a Christian when I was 10 years old at the Unity Church, Unity Presbyterian Church, down the road, my dad had built, and his brother. And well, when I was graduated from high school, I got away from the Lord. I had a brother who was a very prominent and highly respected among a certain crowd, bootlegger. And he had a very fast car. And I actually had a $75 40 Ford. Big trunk. Great for transporting moonshine whiskey. And great for outrunning the revenuers, as we called them. Okay. And so I stumbled across his still one day, and I started working for him, and I remember the first day I did this, I thought to myself, "Man, this is what I want to do." It's nuts, isn't it? But I said that. As a man, there's a way that seems right. You know, that didn't really seem right. I knew it wasn't right, but I wanted to do it. And it was a kind of a thrill, you know. You kind of hoped the deputy sheriff would fall in behind you. Anyway, we did this at night, delivery at night. My folks never had a clue, okay? I'd go to bed and get up and leave, and they never knew I left. And I'd come back, and, you know, 3 hours later, and they never knew I came back. And they never knew, and thank God they never, ever knew that I did that, okay? And so at the end of the summer, 1953, I went off to Bob Jones University, and my brother went off to Matewan, West Virginia, to the U.S. Penitentiary through a strange, strange, strange process of events. And by the way, we used to talk about who was in the most confinement, me at Bob Jones or... Anyway, I didn't like Bob Jones, but I went there because my mother wanted me. She was always, seemingly always very sick, always praying, reading the Bible, but seemed sick. And that was just something we had in our family. And she was praying, and I would finish school before she died. And when somebody starts talking like that, you got to go where they tell you to go. And so I went off to Bob Jones to please her and my dad, and then I tried to leave every semester for the next 3 or 4 years, but then I got so I liked it, okay? It was good for me. I learned things there, Bob Jones. No nonsense, kind of a military Christian school, Christian military school, And I stayed there 5.5 years and did a graduate project on building a radio station. And I met Nancy by last semester there. And that was a real miracle. And she was a freshman. She was 16 years old. And God worked it out. And we just kind of kept in touch. And then we got married in 1963. And it's been just a wonderful, wonderful trip. 54 years, and I thank God for her. And, well, and I've always said to her, you know, look, this may be the end of life as we know it. Bankruptcy is just around the corner. And she always says, well, okay, don't worry about it. God, it's in God's hands. And I say, well, I do worry about it, but it's good it's in God's hands because it's out of my hands. So God has honored us and helped us. And I want to mention Edward Atzinger, my partner. He's the guy who, by the way, my brother got out of prison, married a great wife, great Christian woman, had three great kids. They all went to Bob Jones University. My son said, I wanted to, my nephew, Brent, said, I'd like to go to Virginia Tech. And my brother says, don't even, he's a rough man, okay? I've never told this story until he died, okay? And anyway, my brother said, Roy, he said, look, don't even talk about that. Don't ever mention that in this house. You're going to Bob Jones. That's it, okay? And my nephew said, well, what should I do? I said, I wouldn't talk about it. So, so he went to Bob Jones, all three of them. And so he was a great friend. And all of my brothers and sisters loved me. And I was the youngest by 6 years. And my sister was one of the first pianists at the country church. She's been pianist there for 75 years. You've met her, Jenna Boykin. You met my sister, Mary Lee. Still teaching school, 87 years old. Pianist for 65 years. That's some sort of a record, 75 years. So anyway, Edward Atzinger became a Christian after high school. Nancy actually was instrumental. She led him to the Lord. He saw her life, and then he came to her one day and said, look, I want to become a Christian. It's the most dramatic story I've ever heard. But he came to Bob Jones, and he did well there, majored in speech, and then he went to the University of Southern California, got a master's degree, and got a professorship at L.A. City College. And then he wanted to get into radio. Had a great, great career ahead of him. And he wanted to, so he came to Garner, North Carolina, and got a little radio station that he started just like I started mine in Roanoke, Virginia, when I was, by the way, 23, a little bit younger than 36, but that's close, General Mace. Time magazine got that part wrong. Anyway, he started that station with no money. Okay, you don't have to have money to start a good thing. What you got to have is vision, money, vision and determination and a God-given determination and God-inspired. That's what you need. You don't need money. I didn't have money. Edward didn't have money. But he built this little radio station. He and his wife started running it. And they went a little mobile home out in the cow pasture. And no money down sort of stuff. And so he thrived. It did well. He started another station. Then we started buying them together. And we started Salem. I want you to really understand this now. We started Salem because we had an opinion. First and foremost, we want to build radio stations and buy radio stations to present the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ by the very best communicators of the gospel in the world, okay? And God sent those people to us, and they're great, as Hugh mentioned. And we've started, and then we said, let's concentrate on the big cities. It costs millions of dollars to buy a radio station. And we said, let's do it. And we prayed, and we had a pivotal prayer meeting in Boston. We were at the Hilton Inn at Logan Field. And we were all sharing a room, Nancy and Edward and I. That's what we did in those days. He's her brother, okay? So it's no problem. We shared a little room together, two beds, two normal beds, size beds, and okay. So we had the opportunity to buy a radio station there for $200,000, which was a lot of money back then, a lot of money. And it was in Newton, way out there. You could get it in Boston, but you had to want to get it. You could hardly get it. And then another guy, Tech Ops, had a big station, WEZE, 5,000 watts day and night, covered the whole city. And what should we do? They wanted $2.5 million. $2.5 million for a radio station to preach the gospel? And so we got on our knees at that Hilton Inn, Logan Field, and we prayed. We all prayed, and then Edward prayed, and should we do it, should we not? And then he got to the end of his prayer, and then he asked the question, well, Lord, why not the best for the kingdom of God? Why not the best for the kingdom of God? And we got up from that prayer and said, okay, we know what we got to do now. We got to buy this station. All we got to do is figure out how. How to get $2.5 million. Still paying a house payment, okay? And so he went home. I called the people up, started negotiating with them. And I said, I'll tell you what, look, you got to want to sell us this radio station for us to buy it. And you got to sell it on terms, and you got to lower the price. So we started talking back and forth, and finally they agreed to take $1,800,000 with $400,000 down. And so he went home to borrow $200,000. I went back to Winston, got a second or third mortgage on my house. Amazingly, I was able to get the loan, $200,000. So we bought the station, and the Lord blessed, and he sent us enough to get going. Okay? Didn't get rich, we got going. And the Christian people in Boston to this day, and that's how many years ago? 35, 38 years ago. That station is still running there. So it happened like that I won't tell you everywhere it happened, but it happened in New York, it happened in Philadelphia, it happened in Washington, D.C. We paid $20 million in Washington, D.C., WAVA. And where did this money come from? From God, of course. Chicago and Seattle and Portland and San Francisco and Los Angeles and San Diego and St. Louis and all those big cities in Houston. And God blessed. God provided. And we have big facilities, expensive facilities, and to God be the glory. It's the platform. We build the platform for the best communicators of the gospel. And then we thought, you know, the Judeo-Christian tradition, the biblical Judeo-Christian tradition, like Hugh Hewitt talks about every day on the radio, we said we need the stations in these cities. And so we started building those. And we have those in most of the big cities we're in, not every single one, but most of them. Talk shows, conservative talk shows. We ought to have people on the air who can ably present the Judeo-Christian tradition and talk with people like you who have organizations, like Tony, and tell the story in the best possible way, and it's the truth. So anyway, God has led, and I thank him for it, and I just thank God for sending Edward. He's the bright guy. Okay? He has one challenge. He travels a little too close to the edge. Wouldn't you agree? A little close to the edge on some things financially. And I'm there to kind of draw him back if I can. And anyway, we've had a great trip together, and I just wanted to play that. He's a brilliant man. One of the most smartest, most intelligent people I've ever met in my life, and God called him to do a great thing. Tony, just a word on some of the other activities you mentioned tonight, particularly the kids. We ran for office, Nancy and I, because no one else was running in 64. And I heard Ronald Reagan in Washington at the NRB said, you ought to go home and run for office if no one else is. I went home. Nobody was running for the 5th District U.S. Congress. They said, nobody can win. Steve Neal is there. He's kind of a moderate Democrat. Everybody loves him. Birthday cards to people on their birthdays, and shows up at Christmas at birthday parties for children, writes letters to the Boy Scouts. Everybody liked him. So I said, Nancy, look, I think I should run. Nobody's running. Well, she said, there's nobody else. Maybe you should, but I don't know. Anyway, I went over and signed up. I'd like to say it was a popular demand, okay, but it wasn't. So I became the Christian candidate. Okay. The guy who was against abortion, and I was proud of that. You mean I'd be tagged with that, okay? So we ran. So we ran, and we went all over. Nancy started something called Redheads for Epperson. We got a big button and put it down. And that was good. Okay, Redheads for Epperson. And we did another cute little thing. I met the guy at the airport, and he said, let's debate, and he ran away. And I couldn't get him to debate, and da-da-da. And then I spent all the money I had and all the money I could borrow. You know what you do in candidates, right? You lose your head. You lose control. I promised everybody I talked with everything that they wanted to get. I had bankrupted the U.S. government had I won and had my way. And veterans group, yes. Disabilities, yes. And pension, will it increase? Yes. Social Security, yeah, you write it down, yes. So I had bankrupted the whole country if I had won, and a few people like me. But I lost. Thank God I lost. And I, and so, but the big thing that motivated me and made me go to bed every night, driven and mad, dangerous thing to do, be both, okay, was abortion. Abortion, how can you, how can anybody do that to unborn children? And so we lost by 1,300 votes, and everybody said, that was close, you ran a wonderful race. And frankly, I was thinking, how am I going to pay this debt off? And so we got up the day after the election, and we wanted to go to the air, we said, told the staff, meet us at the headquarters, and we were driving over. And I said to Nancy, you know, we've just spent all the money we'll ever have in our life, probably. And by the way, I called my aunt. My aunt called me and said, look, I saw you on TV. I heard you on the radio. I saw a newspaper ad. What kind of money are you spending on this campaign? And I said, Aunt Dora, I'm sorry to tell you, but I spent $600,000. And she said, $6,000? What were you thinking? I said, it just got out of control. So we were driving over, and I said, Nancy, this is a waste. It's been a terrible thing. What are we doing? I was just plain dumb. No, not dumb, stupid. And we were talking over, and I said, well, what can we do to redeem this? And she said, well, abortion was important. What can we do there? And I said, you know what? We can start a pregnancy crisis center. We can get people together to stop abortions, talk people out of it. And we walked into the campaign headquarters, and some people were crying, and other people were, lifeblood, rock-solid conservatives, especially on the issue of pro-life. And we went up in front of them and said, listen, we've got good news. We're going to start a pregnancy crisis center, Salem Pregnancy Crisis Center. And everybody looked up, and I said, you're the people who are going to do it. And they all started cheering. And my campaign manager became the executive director. And we started it, and we got a building, and then we got money from people, donating money and volunteers, and spring to life. And just a month ago, we went to the anniversary, and we had 500 people there. And we had a great speaker, and it was just a wonderful celebration. And they've saved thousands of children's lives. Thousands. Now, and one more example is, a guy said to me, you ought to buy a Section 8 housing development, okay? He says, look, you can make a bundle of money. The government sets this up for you. HUD set it up. They got a big book. Get a lawyer. Go through that book. Figure it out. We got a lawyer. Did all that. Tell me how to make money on this. And so we went through it. And so I had it under escrow, thanks to a guy named Brad Croker. And I met it at, by the way, CNP. I want to mention that again in a minute. This is important. And so Brad Croker said, you ought to do this. Make this into a Christian community. So then he died at the age of 32. I had the escrow unfiled, going to buy it, thinking about it. So I said, let me go over and visit this place and see what's going on. So I went over and I sat down on the stone walk at Rolling Hills Section 8 housing. 100 mothers when it's full, 350 children when it's full, and men standing around on the corners, okay? Sperm donors, mostly. You know what I mean by that? Okay, that's what they are. Let's face it. And so, drug dealers and so on. So I sat down and I talked to the kids. What do you want to be? Where's your daddy? Don't know. And on. What do you want to be? These bright-eyed, beautiful children, handsome and beautiful and nice, and their hair was nice and everything. And then some mothers came by. I said, how many children you got? And they'd tell me. And one lady said, I have 5 children. I said, how old are you? You look pretty young. She said, I'm 21. I have twins and 2 boys and a girl. I said, well, tell me about your husband. Oh, I don't have a husband. But she said, let me explain. It didn't start out like this. And she told me about her kids. I said, what are your dreams for the kids? I want a policeman, a fireman, and a doctor, and a school teacher. Big dreams. Huge. Every mother had big dreams. And I said, I thought, you know, how are they going to do this? How are they going to do this? And so I talked some more, and I found out from statistics, they aren't going to do it. You've seen the statistics. More likely, 75% more likely to go into jail, 75% more likely to drop out of school. Drugs, get pregnant by 15. Percentages are sky high if the father is not there. All right? So what are we going to do? It's a crisis. So I asked a few, and then we started Kids Extreme. Everybody said, every mother said, yeah, I'd like for you to come here on Saturday morning and have a Bible club for the kids. That grew into it. We started that, got some people involved, Ron and Jackie Pegram, the same people that helped start Salem Pregnancy, and they got involved. Kids Extreme, go on the internet. If you want to get involved, we'll tell you how. And so, you know, it's done great. We have it in different housing sections, and we're trying to grow it and more. We need more volunteers. Hard to find volunteers to do this sort of work. I found that the church likes to take mission trips to Russia, Ukraine, everywhere, but down the street, okay? So we can all go down the street, and you can drink the water down the street, all right? So anyway, so we started. Anyway, the door is open. Okay, try to help kids. I learned this. Until you get with a kid and start helping them by age 7, they're very hard to help after age 7. You can help. And I've also found out that bringing food at Thanksgiving and Christmas doesn't help all that much. It helps. And backpacks in the fall and shoes, that helps, but not much. It has to be a relationship with individuals to help them get through this. So now my daughter leads a women's group, and Todd is, the men wouldn't come out. And so he started going door to door. My son-in-law, you saw him up here a minute ago, he started going door to door on Saturday morning and talking to the men about the Lord, Jesus Christ. And he found out they're afraid to come out because they're not supposed to be there. They'll lose their welfare payments. And the Section 8 won't let them come. So they're incognito. They're not incognito. They're hidden. So he prays with them, and he's got a list of men who should be marrying the mother of their children. So far, he's got 3 people to get married, and they're hanging together. Three couples by name, and he has a list of names. Tells them about Jesus, helps them get a job. And then, you see, I believe that God put in every one of us men a desire to be the protector, the defender, and also the provider of our children. And when a man can't do that because of lack of education, because of poverty, because of toxic welfare, then he has lost his manhood. All right? So I want to just close with with that. If we don't, okay, the problem is not married, but the big root problem of all of this, and I've employed somebody to do a study to document this, and I believe it, and I confirmed it with Daniel Dreisbach, the historian who was here, that if we don't get the man back into the family to be a man, you can elect all the good people you want, you can donate to political campaigns, you can get out the vote, but politics follows the culture, and if we don't succeed in getting marriage to be the norm rather than the exception. You know what the statistics are, 73% of black kids are illegitimate, not born to a husband and wife. And 22% of white is 35 or something for the whole human race. Fatherless kids make up 22 million people. They make up 7.75% of the entire population of the United States. And the Senator Moynihan said it's 22% in the black community, and it was back then about 5% or something in the white community overall. He said, how can this culture endure? This was his famous report. You can Google it. How can it endure with 22% illegitimacy? Now it's 73%. 73%. So I don't know how to do it. We had a meeting the other night, the New Canaan Society folks. A couple of guys are here, Jay Helvey and Kaleem Andreas and their wives. How do we get people to transition from jail, okay, where the recidivism rate is 66%, to back to normal fatherhood, okay, being a man? And we were talking about some ideas. Get them to go to an institution that can help them learn character, like a rescue mission. You've heard of rescue missions, but you can't call it that. Anyway, we need to think about that, how to get the man back into the family as the provider and defender, and change the welfare, reform the welfare, reward people for getting married, and not cut their benefits when they separate and have more children, illegitimacy. Okay? You agree with me? Okay, anyway. Tony, I'm all done. That's my agenda. Thank you again for this. Will you get together and break bread together? Will you get together at New Canaan 3 or 4 times a week in the morning at 7 o'clock? A group of men get together. Jay Helvey lost for Congress, came home and started New Canaan Society. He and his wife Jane are here. And Kaleem, and it's been a great institution. He's become a national leader. We're going to get this started all over the country, calling men to be men again and fathers and not recipients of toxic welfare. Okay, and then Kaleem is a Lebanese, came to America, successful businessman, successful entrepreneur. He invites, if the project comes up that some need in our community, he has 100 people over to his house and gives them a big Lebanese feast. And Lebanese know how to cook, I got to tell you. Anyway, Paula does that, his wife. Anyway, hook up with a New Canaan Society somewhere. In growing old, I trust this eulogy was very premature. Okay, and I've read some books on growing old and how to go quietly, as we say. Anyway, Cicero wrote the best book. No, God wrote the best book, the Bible. It tells what you to do. Trust in the Lord. All things work together for good that them love God. It's there. Okay, read the Bible. I do it every day for at least 30 minutes. Through the Bible, my son-in-law John said, read, this is good, 17 years ago. Every year, through the Bible, with commentary. And I'm closer to what God wants me to be when I do that than when I skip it. That's what I'd like for you to do. And then if you're growing old, and some people here are, no, everybody is. What am I talking about? Everybody's growing old. They asked Cicero in 44 B.C., what's your secret? He was a famous Stoic writer, lecturer, advisor, soldier, lawyer. Cicero said in the book, How to Grow Old, he said, well, true, most old people are grumpy. They wanted to grow old, and when they got there, They didn't know what to do, and they regretted growing old, but didn't want to die, but just regretted being old, okay? But he says, I've come to realize that God, he said nature, but he meant God. God has planned this whole thing. Old age is totally predictable. We all want to get there, and we know we're going to get there if we live. No one wants to die in their 40s and 50s unless they're crazy or something. Anyway, so he said, what I've learned is this. I have been stripped of many of my passions. I've had great experience. I have learned a lot. And now without the youthful passions that were distracted, the youthful passions that were distracting me, I am able to be an example, a better role model, and help other people understand what life is about. And I love being old. And he said, besides, I've taken up gardening. And he has two chapters on gardening. Well, I haven't taken up gardening. But he said one thing that really rang a bell. He said, Richard, the last act of any play is always the best act. Would you agree? General Meese, would you agree? The last act. So I find myself in the last act. And I'm trusting God through Jesus Christ, my Savior, to make this the last act. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stu Epperson. You may be seated for just a moment. We're going to wrap up our time together tonight as Stu Epperson Jr., little Stu, comes to lead us in our benediction. And Stu, now I know why Nancy was so excited when we said we were going to have a hotel room for you here, one just for you and Nancy. Please welcome Stu Epperson Jr.
I'm in a bit of a pickle here because I prepared about 20 pages of notes, about an hour of comments here, because someone sent me an email saying that Stu Epperson was being honored. And I received all kinds of gracious commendations and congratulations. And in the halls, even here, everyone congratulating me and hugging me for this award, but it's that Stu Epperson, not this one. So I want to make sure that's clear, and I apologize for those that I've been facetious with and enjoyed a good laugh with. Proverbs 22, verse 1. A good name is better to be chosen than great riches, and loving favor better than silver and gold. And so, Dad, Mr. Epperson, Pops, thank you for giving from Mom and my sisters and my awesome brother-in-laws and my wife and all the grandkids. Thank you for giving us Dad. Thank you for giving us a good name. And we love you. Now some of you may want to know where the Epperson name came from. Anyone want to know that real quick here? Just real quick. Okay, when the bell tolled in 1596, this little thing called the Reformation that shook the world, the bell tolled in 1596, and that was a signal to legally kill all Huguenots and Reformers, and among whom were the Moravians and others, and Calvinists and so on and so forth. Well, the Epernon family fled France and somehow ended up in America, changed their name to Epperson. And William Epperson settled in Patrick County, Virginia, where Dad was born a few generations later. And so there's a great heritage that I wanted to share that with you, very significant. And I want to also give Dad a gift. Would everyone like to give him a little something here? Okay, here's a little gift to you, Dad. His favorite verse. Romans 8, verse 1. Just the first, we'll just quote, learn, let's just learn that with me real quick, will you? The first part. If you know it, say it with me. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Say that with me again, a little bit louder. Come on. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And his favorite media of choice that he may have come up with, Instagram. We're going to go right here and we're going to share that verse with everybody. Can you guys say that with me? Romans 8, 1. Hold on now. Here we go. In honor of Big Stu, there he is right there. We're going to say his favorite verse all together here. Ready? Romans 8, 1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Awesome. That's going to the Graham fam. That verse is very significant to Dad, and that verse has been his heart, and that verse has guided how he has led our family. That verse has guided how he has been the dad in our home. And I wanted just to say thank you, Dad, for loving my mom. And thank you for loving me and my sisters. And thank you for loving your children. And thank you for loving a bunch of other kids that weren't my brothers and sisters. Okay? Now, his brother, Arat, Virginia, came home and started a radio station. If it weren't for Uncle Ralph, who's in heaven, we wouldn't be doing any of this stuff. Okay? I'm a third generation Christian broadcaster. Uncle Ralph had a grandson who was a rough kid, a real rough kid, a big, strong kid, and just didn't have a rudder and had a real tough home situation and was putting fists through walls and through people. And he was the toughest kid around. He would go pick a fight with a bouncer at the bar, and it didn't go well for the bouncer. And when this kid was in his adolescent years, Mom and Dad did something that was very uncomfortable for me and my three sisters, Christy, Karen, and Catherine. He brought this kid into our home, and we were like, "What are you doing? We're the kid. This is, you know, he's not our brother. He's our cousin. What are you thinking?" And he was rough. And what do? Dr. Perkins, with a rough kid, where do you send a rough kid? Dr. Perkins, where are you? Where do you send a rough kid to get him right? The Marine Corps. Yes, sir. So they sent him to the Marine Corps. And God radically saved this young man. And he went and fought for us on a tour of duty in Iraq. Came home, got a law degree, went back and fought again on another tour voluntarily. And he loves Jesus with all his heart. And he's one of our warriors, and now he's an entrepreneur, broadcaster, and a part owner of his own radio company, doing wonderful. And he's here tonight with his wife, Annette. Brian, will you stand up, and let's honor you. Brian and Annette are here. Where are you, buddy? Love this young man. There's Annette, his wife. One of my heroes right there. But that's the heart that Dad has had, to lead other people to Jesus Christ and to make a difference. And I just want to, just two words come to mind real quick, and then I'm going to close this in prayer. Finishing strong. And this is what comes to my mind and so many others. Dad, Stuart Epperson Sr., is a great example of finishing strong. Of course, you might argue that maybe he's just warming up. Because do you know any other 80-plus-year-olds who ride 20 miles a day on a bike, who ride into the worst neighborhoods in the hood just to do Bible study with young men, who goes and takes kids to church? He's on his cell phone calling them. Are you ready? Antoine, are you ready for church? I'm going to be there. You be ready. I didn't ask you if your mom was up or not. Are you ready? I don't want to hear about what this guy's doing. Are you ready for church? And he picks him up in his big Mercedes SUV on Sunday morning and takes him to church and takes him to eat. Now, when's the last time you took someone to church? Why don't we do that anymore? Call someone, I'm coming to pick you up and I'm going to take you to church. Who does that anymore? An 80-year-old man does. So finishing strong or just warming up. And so I just want to make this statement and I want to ask you this question. Who's closer to God because you're alive today? Because you got out of bed this morning, who's closer to God? And I want to thank God that a bunch of people, including me, are closer to Him and know him because of my dad, Stu Epperson, Sr. So, Dad, I love you, and I still want to be just like that guy whenever I grow up. And can we bow our heads and all pray together, please? Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can call you Father because of this beautiful thing called grace, which is a gift, which is free. But we thank you that that grace meant the greatest price, the greatest sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. We thank you that there's therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And Heavenly Father, our prayer, and I know my dad's prayer, is that everyone in this room would not just know about you, but would personally know you, receive the Savior into their life, receive forgiveness of sins, and be set free from the law of sin and death. And that's my prayer, that's my dad's prayer. And also right now, with every head bowed, would you do this for Dad, in honor of Dad? Would you just picture someone who's maybe worse off than you, who's maybe not got a dad, who needs someone to come alongside and mentor, disciple, whatever you call it. Will you all with me, with your heads bowed, with my head bowed, just picture that person. And just take a second right now, all of us, everyone on the stage, everyone in the audience, just take 1 second and just pray, just a few moments here, and pray for that person by their name. Just pray for them right now. And ask God to show you how to love them, to build a relationship with them, to be a vessel of his grace in their life. And Heavenly Father, we collectively lift up each person. Lord, if each person in here will go out and touch one other person, Lord, that's discipleship. That's the Great Commission. We're going to transform this country because your grace is going to flow through us to others, just like Big Stu has done in so many lives. Thank you for his legacy. Thank you that when we point to him, he points straight up to the Lord Jesus Christ, before whom we will all bow and confess as Lord. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus, and for his praise and for his glory, that we can all say, Amen.
Yolanda Parker is going to come again, and we are going to close with God Bless America. So if you'll stand with me, and let me remind you to join us in the morning at 9 a.m. for our own church service this morning before we depart to go home. Please welcome once again Yolanda as she leads us in God Bless America.
Yeah. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above, from the mountain.
Good night, everyone, and thank you for being a part of the 2017 Values Voter Gala. For those that are around, we'll see you in the morning at 9 o'clock.